from city to city, our journey continues in search of the most sanctified place of worship, the Masjid, to bring you the glorious sermon on the day of Friday, to re-establish your connections with your Creator and awaken your sleeping faith, inshallah. My name is Muhammadul Mahfouz Bashir.
And I am Khadija Muhammad. It's another beautiful and blessed Friday. And of course, we come to you to present to you another educative, informative, and inspiring sermons from mosques across the country. And you know, this is Khutbah Channel. And together we say,
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. MashaAllah. So now we call for the hadith of the day.
And of course, the hadith of the day is scrolling down your screen. And you know, it's there to inspire you and to bring you closer to your Maker and the Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him.
MashaAllah. MashaAllah. So that was the hadith of the day, in fact, to get you closer to your Maker, inshallah. So we call for the motivational message of the day. Do stay tuned. Enjoy.
My name is Yusuf Abdul-Jalil. I'm a level 400 biomedical engineering student and a member of Ghana Muslim Student Association, University of Ghana, Legon branch. Alhamdulillah. We thank Almighty Allah for this opportunity. We send praises to Almighty Allah, the most merciful, the most beneficent. We also send blessings and salutations to His noble Prophet Muhammad. Peace and blessing be upon him and upon all the prophets who came before him, and to those of his household, his companions, and whoever that has held the deen very high and has preserved it so much so that it has reached generations until our turn. Alhamdulillah. Briefly, I think that I have to say that we should be thankful for being Muslims in the first place. Islam is a gift to us as Muslims. The creator of the universe has created the world and created mankind. And so he has to give mankind the path to gaining a successful hereafter. Now, as people of faith, we all believe that there's life after here. So in order to be successful in the life after here, we have to adhere to the codes that have been laid down from the creator of this universe through his messengers and prophets, peace be upon them all. Now, to go briefly to my message, I would like to say that a lot of the problems that we face here today as Muslims is basically due to some petty differences amongst ourselves. And oftentimes, certain differences like tribe, race, ethnicity, this shouldn't have been an issue for us as Muslims. But we happen to focus on this so much so that one thing that is very essential to the life of a Muslim or Muslims in general, which is the unity, is oftentimes disregarded. Now, if we are to adhere to this principle that has been laid down from the time of the Prophet to now, which is the fact that Muslims are supposed to stay united, a lot of the problems we see in the world would have been solved, especially the problems of immigration, refugee crisis, among others, would have been solved. And so we have to go back to our teachings and ensure that as a people, we stay more united, and as an ummah, we stay more united. Now, as we talk about unity, oftentimes we blame our leaders, or whether globally or locally, for some of the problems we face in terms of unity. But I think that we have to look ourselves in the mirror and reflect upon ourselves. What are we doing in our own quarter, in our own small way, in our own small corner, in our own communities, to also ensure that this unity, the brotherliness, togetherliness, is also revived. So as we criticize or even blame our leaders for some of these shortcomings, we ourselves will have to look ourselves in the mirrors and reflect, keep pondering What are you doing to help if your brother is in a problem? Do you feel for the brother or you live a life of your own without taking into account the life of other Muslims as well? Like the Prophet said, we are like one human body. When one part hurts, the whole body feels the pain. Is that the situation now, or we just living like robots where we don't feel the pain of that of other Muslim brothers and sisters as well? So as we would like to see our leaders, both globally and locally, try to unite as a people to solve our problems as Muslims, also have to look ourselves in the mirror, reflect all the time. Whatever activity that we take part in our daily endeavors, we have to take into consideration the welfare of fellow Muslim brothers and sisters as well. Moreover, I would like to add that as a people, we need to be more patient, especially as Muslims. Patience is very key in Islam, and this cannot be overemphasized, as the Quran and the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has really highlighted this a couple of times or a lot more times. No, and just to add, if you look at significance of unity in Islam, for instance, if you look at the various tenets of Islam from the five pillars, among other things, oftentimes most of these tenets are practiced in congregation. So look at the five pillars of Islam. We gather five times a day in the mosque together, and all this is to bring us together as a people and not divide us. So instead of staying divided, I think we have to work on our unity a lot more, and a lot of our problems will be dealt with. To the patience, again, being patient is a virtue that you can't do away with as a Muslim. And so we have to, again, reflect and see whatever action we take. Are we being patient enough? Are we being patient enough before we proceed with whatever action that we decide to take? I also like to add that, you see, as Muslims, we have to be steadfast and have to develop forbearance as well, especially in times like this. Because we live in times when you hear a lot of people say a lot of bad things about Islam and Muslims. And these are things that are worrying. First of all, as Muslims, we are flag bearers of our religion. So we have to be cautious of how we live our life in the sight of the public. Because a lot of people who take what you do to be the real teachings of Islam without visiting the sources. And so we have to, as flag bearers, play our part very well in ensuring that people don't misconstrue our religion to be something else, which is not. So having said that, I also like to say that, you know, in times like this, we have to be more steadfast in living in our societies. So like I said, we have a couple of incidences, or it's become predominantly the norm for people to sort of lampoon certain things about Islam, to even talk about Islam badly and all that. But we have to remember that, you know, like the Quran said, you can't just say you believe without you being tested. So we can see this as a test from Almighty Allah that we have to endure. So when people say bad things about Islam, don't emotionally hurts you, but you should understand that that's a test you have to pass. People have endured even more difficult times more than this, physically, emotionally, financially. A lot of the times we deal with some of this and just emotionally, but we still have to forbear and be steadfast in our activities and whatever we do. That's finally what I would like to leave with everybody. And alhamdulillah, the tongue Almighty Allah. We pray that everything in our communities become better. May Almighty Allah make it easy for us.
Welcome back. That was the motivational message of the day. And mashallah, I hope it has inspired you to go out there to do things you are always scared and afraid to do.
Mashallah, that was a beautiful one from my sister here. So inshallah, it is time for us to do things of greatness for ourselves. So to our location of the day, we are in the premium university of the country, Legon precisely. So inshallah, you should expect an inspiring message today from the Imam. So we go in and hear what the Imam has for us today. But you can get interactive with that on our Facebook page or catch the episode that you have missed by subscribing to our YouTube channel, inshallah. So we will see you after the sermon. Do stay tuned.
أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين نسأل الله تعالى أن يرزقنا إيمانا صادقا وأن يعرفنا بديننا نحمده ونشكره ونتوب إليه ونستغفره إنه هو أرحم الراحمين ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له نسأله أن يشرح لنا صدورنا ونشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله قال له أبو ذر الغفار يا رسول الله أوصني فقال له صلى الله عليه وسلم عليك بالتقوى الله فإنها رأس الأمر كلها قال زدني فقال عليك بتلاوة القرآن وذكر الله فإنهما نور لك في الأرض وفي السماء اللهم صل وسلم عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد فيا عباد الله المسلمين اتقوا الله وأطيعوه ولا تعصوه وعاملوه معاملة من يخافه ويرجوه فقد وعد المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار ووعدهم النصر في الدنيا وفي الآخرة فحققوا إيمانكم بصدق ولا تكونوا كالمجرمين الذين لا إيمان لهم واحفظوا أنفسكم عن الأشرار فإن الأشرار من أسباب الندم يوم القيامة إن الإيمان الصادق يحمل على العمل الصالح وإن العبد إذا آمن بالله الواحد القهار النافع الدار المعطي المانع خافه واتقاه وأطاعه ولا يعصيه والمؤمن يتوكل على الله ومن يتوكل على الله فهو حسبه فمن أعرض عن طاعة الله واتبع هواه أذله وأخزاه المؤمن إذا أصابه خير شكر الله وإن أصابه الشر وإن أصابه الشر رضي بقضاء الله وصبر المؤمن يشكر الله ويعلم أن النعم من فضل الله فيصرفها فيما شرع جل جلاله ولقد ذكر الله صفات المؤمنين بقوله تعالى إنما المؤمنون الذين إذا ذكر الله وجلت قلوبهم وإذا تليت عليهم آياته زادتهم إيمانا وعلى ربهم يتوكلون الذين يقيمون الصلاة ومما رزقناهم ينفقون أولئك هم المؤمنون حقا الإيمان يحمل المؤمن على القيام بحق الله وحقوق عباده الإيمان يحمل على الأخلاق الفاضلة وبعصم الله به ويعصم الله به عن الأخلاق الرذيلة ألم تعلم أن كثيرا من الناس أهلكهم حب الشهوات والأخلاق الرذيلة فمن لم يتمكن للإيمان من قلبه لم يكن بحق الله ولا بحقوق عباده ولن ينفع بما قسم الله ولم يقنع بما قسم الله له ولن يتحقق له الصدق في المعاملات والعبادات فكل أمر لا يبنى على الإيمان بالله فهو هبوط ودمار الإيمان يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وينهى عن الإثم والعدوان المؤمن منيب إلى الله حريص على إصلاح قلبه نقي باطنه بحسن النية وحسن عبادة الله يحسن خلقه مع عباد الله يأمر بالخير ويدعو إخوانه إلى الأعمال الصالحة المؤمن سليم القلب صادق اللسان إن أعطي شكر وإن ابتلي صبر وإن أذنب استغفر عاملا بقول الله تعالى لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة وإن من الناس من يدعي الإيمان وباطنه تخالف ظاهره فالإيمان ليس بالتمني ولكن ما وقر في القلب وصدقه العمل كيف تدعي الإيمان وأنت تتناقضه بالنفاق والفسوق والمعاصي أين علامات الإيمان في المنافق والكذاب والزاني والسارق والقاطع الطرق وشارب الخمر والمتكبر فيا عباد الله اتقوا الله وفرقوا بين أسباب الربح والخسران على كل مسلم أن يعلم أن الإيمان قول باللسان وعمل بما شرعه الله جل جلاله ويرضاه أيها المسلم تذكر واستعد فإنك ميت عن قريب وترك الجهل واللهو فكم من شيخ يسيه يا حسرته على ما قدمت يداه وكم من شاب يسيه يا أسفاه على ما ضيع من شبابه ولا تغرنكم هذه الحياة الدنيا فهي أيام معدودات واتقوا الله في جميع أحوالكم واصبروا على ما ينالكم فإن الإنسان في هذه الدنيا يبتلى بالخير والشر فهو بحاجة إلى الصبر والصبر هو نصف الإيمان فإن الإيمان نصفان نصف صبر ونصف شكر أيها الأخ التفت النظر إلى قصة القميص يوسف بن يعقوب عليه السلام وجاءوا على قميصه بدم كذب وقالوا ليعقوب عليه السلام وما أنت بمؤمن لنا ولو كنا صادقين لقد عاد الأولاد جميعا ما أدى يوسف ماذا حدث أين أخوكم قالوا يا أبانا إنا ذهبنا نستبق وتركنا يوسف عند متاعنا فأكله الذئب وما أنت بمؤمن لنا ولو كنا صادقين أي إنك لا تأمن لنا ولو ثبت صدقنا لديك وأرادوا أن يقيموا دليلا فجاءوا بالقميص وعليه دم شاة كذب ونظر يعقوب إلى القميص عجبا وسلم الأمر لله عز وجل أي ذئب في الدنيا آكل يأكل صاحب القميص دون أن يحدث في القميص أي دون أن تمزق القميص بل سولت لكم أنفسكم أمرا فصبر جميل فجاء الله فقضاء الله لا يقابل بغير التسليم سلم يعقوب عليه السلام الأمر لله فصبر جميل والله المستعان على ما تصفون اسمع نبينا في الحديث القدسي يقول جل شأنه إذا ابتليت عبدي ببلاء في نفسه أو في ماله أو في أهله فصبر استحييت منه يوم القيامة أن أنصب له ميزانا وأدخله الجنة بغير حساب إنما يوفى الصابرون أجرهم بغير حساب فاستغفر الله العظيم إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء. Praise be to Allah, the Lord of the universe. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to perfect our religion and give us sincere faith. We are praying to Him, we are praying to Allah. May He teach us and let us understand our religion properly. We praise Him and thank Him. We turn to Allah in repentance. We ask Him for forgiveness. He is the most forgiving. We testify that there is no God except Allah. He has no partners. We are asking Allah to purify our hearts. We also testify that the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a servant and a messenger. The Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked by one of his companions called Abu Zarr al-Ghifari. He said to him, "Oh, Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I am asking you to advise me." Then the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, "Ya Abu Zarr al-Ghifar, oh Abu Zarr al-Ghifar, I advise you to be God-fearing." Then he said to the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Add me more. I want more advice." Then he said to him, "Alayka bi tilawati al-Quran wa zikrillah." The other things I will advise you with is to be reciting the Quran. Recite the Quran, and I also urge you to be remembering Allah, remembrance of Allah. These two things are light for you in this world. These two things are light for you in the hereafter. Brothers and sisters in Islam, we invoke Allah, we supplicate to Him, we ask Him to show mercy and His blessings unto the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Brothers and sisters in Islam, let us remember, I urge you and I urge myself, that the life of Prophet Joseph gives us stories. Stories that provide a role model for patience and steadfastness in the face of hardships, and gives an example of a happy conclusion after misfortunes by God's grace. It means that today's khutbah is to call our attention to how we should build patience in the face of hardships. I therefore call unto you and call unto myself, brothers and sisters in Islam, let us be God-fearing. Let us be obedient to Allah. Do not let us disobey Allah. Let us relate to Allah in a way that we are pious. Let us be pious. Let us demonstrate piety in our relationship to Allah. Let us relate to Allah in a way that one needs Him. Brothers and sisters in Islam, because Allah has promised that believers who are engaged in righteous deeds, Allah has promised them paradise. Brothers and sisters, indeed, Allah has promised those who relate to Him with piety, He has promised them success and victory in this world and in the hereafter. Let us therefore make our faith in Allah a reality. Brothers and sisters in Islam, I am calling unto myself and calling unto you. Let us be sincere in our faith in Allah. Let us be sincere in our belief to Allah. Do not let us be like those who have passed before us without faith in Allah. Do not let us be like those who have passed on without faith in Allah. Brothers and sisters in Islam, let us protect ourselves from engaging and indulging in sin. Brothers and sisters in Islam, let us remember that engaging in sin, engaging in bad deeds, at the end of it, will lead one to regret. You will regret it in this world and you will regret it in the hereafter. Brothers and sisters in Islam, Prophet Joseph or Prophet Yusuf had a strong faith in Allah. This faith helped him through the ordeal of hardships. He was not scared, and his faith in Allah kept on reassuring him a comfortable life in the face of all the difficulties. He spent his time in a well. He spent his time in prison. And all along, it never deterred him from moving away from Allah. He kept on praying to Allah during these times of difficulties. He never threw up his arms in despair. It rather strengthened him. I am asking myself, and I'm also asking the congregation, how do you conduct yourself in the face of difficulties? I am asking you, what is your position the time that you are in the middle of problems? Don't you forsake Allah? Are you not fed up with Allah because you are going through a difficulty? This khutbah is asking you, was it what Prophet Joseph did when he was in the middle of problems? In the same way that a true believer of Allah, if he's facing difficulties, the attribute he shows here is patience. And as a result of the patience, in the final analysis, it becomes a good omen for him. A believer in Allah is always thankful to Allah. Brothers and sisters in Islam, indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has reminded us of some descriptions of believers. And he says, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهِ, that believers are those when they find themselves anywhere and the name of Allah is remembered. True believers of Allah, the wealth and the money that Allah has endowed them with, they spend some for the welfare of others. They give it out to the needy. They give it out to the poor, showing that they are acknowledging that it is Allah who has provided them with that blessing, with that favor. You have a duty and responsibility towards your fellow human being. Apart from your duty and responsibility towards Allah, and the first among Allah's creation in human beings that you owe an obligation and responsibility is your two parents, your father and the mother. That is why Allah tells us in the Quran, وَقَدَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Immediately he mentions that Allah has decreed, وَقَدَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّا, that you worship none apart from him. He says, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. From moral behaviors that will defame our integrity, that will let us lose our honor as Muslims. We are reminded again, brothers and sisters in Islam, as Muslims, let us appreciate what God has allocated to us. Let us appreciate and accept Allah's share that He has given to us. Let us take it in good faith. It should come as a result of our iman. I am again reminding myself and reminding the jama'ah that anything that is not built on faith in Allah will not end up well. It will finally collapse. Whatever you are going to do, you must do it built on an intention. And the premise of that intention should come from your faith in Allah. And it should be sincere. Your faith in Allah as a believer should let you be just. In whatever position you are occupying, you must demonstrate judgment based on your faith in Allah, and that should lead you to be just. Your faith in Allah should lead you to become righteous. Your faith in Allah should let you abstain from evil and from sin. Your faith in Allah should allow you to refrain from enmity. Right now we are sitting here. There is hatred going on between us. We envy one another. We hate one another. And yet we say we are sincere believers in Allah. We are enemies and yet we want Allah's paradise. Is it possible that Allah will put us in paradise when we hate one another, when we are enemies towards one another? Is it possible? The Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has spoken to his companions and by extension has spoken to all of us. Do I show you things that you will do? And when you do it, you will go to a Jannah, you will go to paradise. And the companion said, yes. And the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, openly greet one another. When you greet one another, you will love one another. And when you love one another, you will go to paradise. A believer in Allah enjoys goodness in his community. A believer in Allah will forbid evil in community. A believer in Allah, Allah will try you. If you are a sincere believer in Allah, remember that Allah will try you, and when Allah tries you, you must demonstrate patience. A believer in Allah will once in a while wrong Allah. And when you wrong Allah, you show remorse and ask for Allah's forgiveness. And these are attributes of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The good virtues, the moral values that the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam were the moral values of a believer. And that is why the Quran tells us, وَلَكُمْ فِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. And indeed, in the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you have a good example. You have a good example because his way of life was built on his belief in Allah, sincerity. The khutbah goes on to ask us a basic question in our life. How do you claim that you are a sincere believer in Allah and yet your day-to-day life contradicts your faith, what you say you believe in? Why do you claim that you are a believer in Allah and yet you are a hypocrite? Is it possible to claim that you are a believer in Allah and you are a liar? You are someone engaged in immoral sexual acts. You are a thief, an armed robber. Can you still claim to be a believer in Allah? Brothers and sisters in Islam, let us be God-fearing. Let us be able to distinguish between things that will do and earn a reward and things that will do and will not earn a reward. Let us try to distinguish between things that we'll do and Allah will pay us, and no things that we'll do and Allah will punish us. It's not surprising that a young man at the point of death will start crying. Crying because of the time he has wasted, the youthful days he has wasted, which he or she could have put into better use. Do not allow the temporal enjoyment in this world to deceive you and me. Because our life in this world is numbered. Let us be God-fearing. Everywhere we find ourselves, let us be patient. Let us remember that in this world, Allah is out to try us. Allah will try us with good things. Allah will try us with difficulties. Sometimes fortunes from Allah are trials to you. And sometimes misfortunes from Allah are also trials to you. But in whatever situation you find yourself, remember that patience is best fitting. Remember that your faith is made up of two components. Half of your faith is patience, and the other half is showing thankfulness to Allah. my brother, my sister in Islam, at this point, I will therefore urge you, and I will urge myself, let us take a lesson, let us take a look at the story of Prophet Yusuf and his brothers in the Quran. Prophet Yusuf was the son of another prophet, Prophet Jacob, Yaqub. What happened between them? They had gone out. He had gone out with his senior brothers. And imagine I'm saying a blessing, or Allah's trial can come in the form of blessings. Prophet Yaqub was blessed by Allah with many children, about 11 or more boys. It's a blessing. Here we are, some of us are here. Not one child. I will remind you that consider it as a trial from God. Allah is tampering with your patience. In the same way, the 11 children Allah gave to Prophet Yaqub was a trial. Because there was disunity among the 11 children. They envied their junior brother, Yusuf. They went out with him against their father's will. Because in their own perception, Prophet Yusuf, as a little boy, had the attention of their father. It was a trial. They decided to go out with him and do away with him. And in this story, Allah put so many lessons for you and me. They went out with him and they came back without him. Then the father asked, "Where is your brother?" Then, what did they say? "We went out with him. We were playing, and we left him to take care of our things. When we came back, he had been eaten up by a hyena or a wolf." So in order to convince their father, they kill one of the lambs, and then they stained the dress with the blood and presented it to their father as evidence. Now let us look at this scenario very critically. The children, before they presented their evidence to their father, they said, "This is the case, this is what happened, but we are aware that you will not believe us because you do not trust us." The children had acknowledged and admitted that their father did not believe them. Their father did not trust them. It gives us lessons how we as parents, we are relating with our children in the house. Do you bring up your children in such a way that you trust them? Do you bring up your children in such a way that they are aware that my parents do not believe me? And this was the situation, and it was a trial to the prophet. It means the children themselves knew that they were not leading righteous lives. So they advanced that this is the story, but we are aware that you will not even believe us. And they presented him with evidence. And the evidence was that the dress Prophet Yusuf was wearing that day, they had stained it with the blood and presented to their father to prove their case that a wolf had eaten up their brother. The father took the dress and looked at it and said to himself, and he put everything in the hands of Allah. Why did he put it in the hands of Allah? He looked at the dress. Yes, the dress was stained with blood. But which clever wolf will take his time to undress a boy and put the dress down and chop the boy? Because it did not occur to them that if the wolf had eaten up Prophet Yusuf, the dress would have been torn. And what did Prophet Yusuf say? "For sobran jamil." In this occasion, on this instant, patience is befitting. Somebody losing a son. Says he has put everything in the hands of Allah. He believes in Allah. In this time of difficulty, Allah will intervene. I am calling unto myself. Probably you have also gone through such difficulties. Probably you have gone through such hardships. Have you taken your time to sit down and know that whatever good is coming from Allah. Whatever bad you are facing is also coming from Allah. And that is why the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in the Hadith al-Qudusi that Allah says that if I try or examine or test my servant in his life or in his wealth or in his family, and he demonstrates patience and tolerance on the day of judgment, I feel shy to put skill of this before him, to judge him before I ask him to go to Jannah. I will just say, go and enter Jannah without questions, without reckoning. On this note, my brothers and sisters in Islam, let us use these lessons and advise ourselves as Muslims. I will take this opportunity to call onto every Muslim here. Muslims must be prepared to sacrifice in order that Allah's word may be held supreme. Prophet Yusuf and his father were prepared to sacrifice because they wanted Allah's word to become supreme. Let us remember that the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions did just that. They sacrificed before Allah gave them victories and success in their expeditions. They sacrificed before Allah gave them supremacy over their enemies. As Muslims, we need to remain steadfast, and Allah will give us victory without us having to fight for it. Let me remind you that in Islam, two brothers or sisters who boycott each other will have their prayers not rise a foot over their heads. We are here, we do not love one another, and we claim we are Muslims. We hate one another. We do not greet one another. We are fighting with one another. And the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reminding me and you that when we remain in these conditions without greeting one another, our prayers will not rise a foot above our heads. Let us, we profess to believe in Allah, but let us always remember our honor as Muslims. Let us always remember our reputation and our image as Muslims. How does it manifest in our belief in Allah? The Ansars, the believers of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, demonstrated their honor, their reputation, based on their belief in Allah. They made a covenant with the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was facing challenges in his birth town Mecca, he met this group of Ansars, people from Medina, who agreed to host him in Medina and ask him to migrate from Mecca to Medina. And they took a pledge with him. Their pledge was that they would support and protect the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he left Mecca and moved to Medina, because they knew that the Quraysh of Mecca will come after the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Just at the time they were going to take this covenant, one of them halted all of them and said, before you take this pledge, I want all of you to give me your attention. I want to ask you something. Are you aware of what you are pledging to this man? You are pledging that you will protect Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You are pledging that you will support him against his own people from Mecca. Do you know what it means? Now listen, you are pledging to support him in the face of killings among your own kinsmen. Because if you protect and support him and the people of Mecca come, they will fight you. And in such a war, people of Medina will die. And these are your tribesmen. These are your kinsmen. Are you prepared to swear that you will protect him when you know very well that you will lose your people? That is one thing. The second thing is that you are pledging to protect and support this man. It will bring about looting in Medina. Because if the people of Mecca come to war with us and they defeat us, they will loot our property. We will lose our wives and we will lose our children. Are you aware of this? The third one is, are you pledging to support and protect this man in the midst of losing your property? Are you prepared to do that? Then he said, if you feel that should this happen and you will suffer the consequences, then I urge every one of you here, I will urge everyone here who wants to pledge to withdraw. If you withdraw now, it is better for you. Make a covenant with this man, and when it comes, you will abandon him. If you abandon him, you will be humiliating yourself in this world, and you will be humiliating yourself before Allah in the hereafter. As Muslims today, back to our honor, our reputation, our image. Are we prepared to do something? Bearing in mind that we need to protect our image before Allah, whatever we are doing as Muslims, are we prepared to bear in mind that we are ready to protect our reputation before Allah? Let us reflect from the lessons we are drawing from the life of Prophet Yusuf and his father, and build our life on the fear of Allah. Build it on patience, and bear in mind that whatever we are going to do, contrary to our faith, our belief in Allah, we will be humiliated in this world and will be humiliated before Allah in the hereafter. May Allah guide us. فَقَدْ أَمَرَكُمْ جَلَّ شَعْنُهُ عَلَى ذَلِكَ اللَّهُمَّ فَصَلِّ عَلَى مُحَمَّدْ وَعَلَى آلِ مُحَمَّدْ كَمَا صَلَّيْتَ عَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَعَلَى آلِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ إِنَّكَ حَمِيدٌ مَجِيدٌ اللَّهُمَّ أَعِزِّ الْإِسْلَامَ وَالْمُسْلِمِينَ وَأَذِلَّ الشِّرْكَ وَالْمُشْرِكِينَ وَدَمِّرْ أَعْدَاءَ الدِّينِ اللَّهُمَّ اهْدِنَا فِيمَنْ هَدَيْتَ وَعَافِنَا فِيمَنْ عَافَيْتَ وَتَوَلَّنَا فِيمَنْ تَوَلَّيْتَ وَبَارِكْ لَنَا فِيمَا أَعْطَيْتَ وَقِنَا وَاصْرِفْ عَنَّا شَرَّ مَا قَضَيْتَ إِنَّكَ تَقْضِي وَلَا يُقْضَى عَلَيْكَ إِنَّهُ لَا يَذِلُّ مَنْ وَالَيْتَ وَلَا يَعِزُّ مَنْ عَادَيْتَ تَبَارَكْتَ رَبَّنَا وَتَعَالَيْتَ لَكَ الْحَمْدُ عَلَى مَا قَضَيْتَ وَلَكَ الشُّكْرُ عَلَى مَا أَعْطَيْتَ نَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَنَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ بِرَحْمَتِكَ يَا أَرْحَمَ الرَّاحِمِينَ قُومُوا إِلَى صَلَاتِكُمْ يَرْحَمُكُمُ اللَّهُ أَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ
Assalamu alaikum, mister.
Yeah, my name is Sharif Karim and I'm from Ekwafuho.
Oh, mashallah. Nice to have you here. Mashallah. Today's khutbah on the remembrance of Allah. What benefit have you got from today's khutbah?
Well, I wouldn't say I came in late, but yes, I came in late, but I really learned a lot from it. And that is to everywhere you find yourself, you should stand as a Muslim.
Mashallah.
And that is a very important message to all our Muslim brothers and sisters across the world. I think it's really important. And kudos to the Imam. Yes, I think some of us really come here sometimes because of these messages. It's really important to us to be able to stand on our feet wherever we find ourselves as Muslims, brothers and sisters.
One more question. How are you able to cope with education, going to lectures here and there, and then your religious activities? Doesn't that affect you in any way?
No, I would say no. Sometimes you also have to, yeah, at least you don't have to put your religion aside. It is what you believe in making you. So sometimes you also have to schedule and then make sure that, yeah, you live up to expectation, not just education, but your religion as well. It's really important.
Thank you very much, sir. Please, your name and where you're coming from to worship.
Abdul Manaf from Commonwealth Hall.
MashaAllah, nice to have you here. Today's khutbah on the remembrance of Allah, inshallah. So what benefits precisely have you got from today?
Actually, I learned that we should imitate the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As Muslim, we shouldn't live anyhow. And then when you look at the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived his life, it depicts that Muslims, we are for peace. So whilst we are trying to follow the directions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we have to humble ourselves and then live as Muslim and not any other individual.
Assalamu alaikum, mister.
Yeah, wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Please, your name and where you are coming from to
worship? I'm Ibrahim Ahmed Akwasi from International Hostel 2.
MashaAllah. Okay, today's sermon was on the remembrance of Allah. What important message have you got from his sermon?
Okay, I've gotten how to be obedient through Islamic way. You have to be obedient to your parents, to your elderly people, and those who are above you, and be obedient to everybody. And you have to be humanity. Yeah.
So, how are you able to cope with educational activities and religious activities on campus?
Well, because on Fridays I have lectures in the morning alone, I'm able to come to mosque on Friday.
So it doesn't bother,
me anyway. It doesn't affect my studies.
Okay. Please, your name and where you are coming from to worship here.
My name is Abdulbari Yakub, and I'm a student here in Lagos.
Oh, mashallah. Nice. Today's khutbah was on the remembrance of Allah. What message have you got for me?
What I got for viewers is that they should, as much as possible, be patient in whatever Allah has decreed upon them.
Mashallah.
Because anything Allah has done upon you is just a test for you to see whether you have faith in Him, or to see whether your faith is just there to measure the level of your faith in Him. Yeah. And also, as much as possible, to love each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Assalamu alaikum, Mr.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.
Please, your name and where you are coming from?
Yeah, I'm Adam Alassan Baba, coming from Adenta.
Oh, mashallah. You are coming from long way to this place. Mashallah. Okay, today's khutbah was on the remembrance of Allah. How are you able to cope with this message in your life, in your social life?
Yeah, this khutbah spoke a lot about how a believer must behave.
Okay.
Let's see, it's all about trials. How God tries his believers, being good or bad. You should always be submissive
and trust
Him, actually. Yeah, whatever comes on your way, you have to welcome it. What a
good fit.
Exactly.
So please, can you share with me and the viewers what you've learned from what the Imam preached on?
Okay, today's khutbah, I learned that whatever situation that you find yourself in, you have to be patient. And that Almighty Allah tests us with certain things in our life, such as death and the loss of loved ones and a whole lot. So when you find yourself in such a situation, you have to be very patient. Sometimes, like he gave an example with the Prophet Yusuf, how the Prophet loved his daughter, some of his sons. He loved some more than others. It's showing us that we have to be careful how we take care of our children. Like, we shouldn't be selective. Like, you love one more than the other. That one too, he talked about it. And then when the other 11 children tried to kill Yusuf, and then they brought Anabi Yaqub noticed that they killed him, but they were lying to him that it was the wolves that killed him. But at that time he made a statement that at this moment it's patient that I'm going to be. So it's teaching us that in whatever situation that we find in ourselves, we have to be patient in it. Like anything at all, sometimes something that you love dearly, Allah will take it from you. That is test your patience. It's a trial that, and at the end of the day, something big will come out of it.
Alaikum, my dear sister.
Wa alaikum salam to lie.
You look beautiful.
Oh, thank you.
Okay, the Imam has preached a lot and we were all present. So I want you to share with me and the viewers out there what you've learned.
Actually, he said a lot. But what I actually admired about is when he did preach on our responsibilities. Like, as human beings, we have two types of responsibility. Our responsibility with Almighty Allah, and then our responsibility with our co-human beings. And then the first people to consider, or whom we are embedded to oblige or to execute our responsibilities to, are our parents, most especially our mothers, and then so our father, of course.
Alhamdulillah, what I learned, or what really like touched my heart, was the aspect of patience. We all know that patience is the pinnacle of everything. If you have patience, you reap the benefits of your hardships in life. So for me, it's patience, and alhamdulillah, I like the sermon. It was just on point. I felt maybe he was talking to me somehow.
She felt like he was. I also enjoy it a lot though. I also enjoy it.
Alhamdulillah, it has always been interactive after the sermon, inshallah. And you've heard from the attendants expressing their satisfaction and how deeply the message has touched them. Let's do all that we can to ensure that we inculcate all that the Imam has said into our life. This will go a long way to ensure that we become Muslims to our lives and our society in general.
Okay, that was a good one from the Imam. In fact, we've all been inspired by what he preached on. You know, throughout the sermon, I've been asking myself, what does it mean to be submissive to Allah? Is it only prayers? No, it's not. If you're out there and you think the same, my dear, just get that out of your head. You have to remember Allah in whatever you do. Your faith, intention, being patient, how you submit to your parents, how you relate to others, it all zeroes down to being submissive to Allah. And it shows how good you are as a Muslim. So please, let's not let our desires and selfish interests take on us so that we will do things that will make us go wayward. We should be able to distinguish between being good and being bad.
MashaAllah. So this brings us to the end of today's episode, inshaAllah. And I hope you have enjoyed it. So you have to stay glued to your TV set at the same time next week to have yet another exciting episode. Until then, my name is Muhammad Al-Mahfouz Bashir.
And I am Khadija Muhammad. But before we go, don't forget to be interactive with us on our Facebook page at Hudba Channel. Or subscribe to our YouTube channel at Hudba Channel.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.